I have a bad habit. People recommend me movies, they beg me to watch them, and I just sit on them for years and years until one night when I'm bored or fed up, I watch them, realise I've lived a poorer life for having not seen these masterpieces up until now, and then immediately regret the years I didn't watch them sooner. 1983's Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence is one of those movies. It was first recommended to me about 15 years ago by my uncle, and I sat on it. I sat on this movie until December 2020 when I spotted it in the Arrow Video Christmas sale, thought it was a good price and remembered how much my uncle had recommended I check it out over the years, before deciding, what the hell, and picking it up. And man oh man, what have I been missing? Describing the plot of the film to you really won't do justice to the movie in all honesty, just giving you a beat by beat playthrough will probably make this picture sound incredibly dry, but I assure you it's a rich, lush production that pretty much succeeds in everything it sets out to do. The film is set in Java during the Second World War, 1942 to be exact, and follows the experiences of John Lawrence, a captured British soldier being held in a Japanese prisoner of war camp. Lawrence speaks fluent Japanese and so has been co-opted by the camp's sergeant, Hara, to act as a translator and negotiator between the guards and Lawrence's other European counterparts. This role equally comes with the additional privilege of giving Lawrence direct access to the camp's captain, Yonoi. The pair regularly talk and on occasion swap ideological and cultural beliefs on the understanding that they're going to work together, at least as best as possible, to try and keep peace at the camp. Yonoi and Hara don't want trouble, and as long as the prisoners do what's asked of them, they'll be treated at least somewhat humanely. However, there is friction. Lawrence's superior is a gentleman by the name of Hixley, and Hixley doesn't see the point in trying to understand Japanese culture or ideology. He finds the Shinto religion to be a load of ballyhoo, and he's neither the time nor patience to work with what he considers the enemy. Unbeknownst to Hixley, Captain Yonoi has grown tired of his attitude and is looking for the means with which to replace him. And he finds that means pretty early into this film's runtime in the form of Jack Celliers. Jack's no-nonsense, blunt and border nihilistic, but he'd take a bullet for anyone and he's the first to step up when some kind of injustice is going on. He was captured while taking part in a secret military campaign to scout out an uncharted area ready for the main invasion. All of Jack's men were killed in the process, and Jack only willingly surrendered when his captors threatened to literally destroy an entire village of people if he didn't give himself up willingly. Jack is made to stand trial for war crimes, and the court is pretty much rigged against him. But Yonoi is working as part of the court team and sees something in Jack that makes him disagree with the other jurors. Despite this, it appears he's going to be sentenced to death by firing squad, which he promptly is. But on the day of Jack's execution, it's actually revealed to be a mock one, and instead he's transferred to Lawrence's POW camp. He's violently beaten to the point that he's hospitalised for a couple of weeks, but he soon finds his place in the camp, helping fallen soldiers, speaking with Sergeant Hara and Yonoi, and living up to his reputation. It's from here that the film really kicks up a level, as we see the tensions rise between Jack, Hixley, Hara and Yonoi, with Lawrence caught in the middle of it all as the mediator. And when several camp incidents take place, including a smuggled secret radio being found and Jack breaking camp rules to bring critically ill hospital patients food, it leads to some fiery and high tension moments that bring into question the foundations of morality, spirituality, religion and what it means to be human in and of itself. I'm not going to spoil any more of this movie because I've already said way too much, but this really is not one to miss. This film found me just at the right time in my life, a couple of years earlier or later, and it probably wouldn't have landed with quite the same impact. But right here, right now, at this exact point in history, it's kind of like all of the planets have aligned perfectly. December 2020 was the year of the pandemic Christmas, and for a lot of people it was a very isolated time. I was equally going through some private issues at the time that had me in a very particular mindset, that also had groundings around isolation, which only amplified my feelings further. And to top it all off, it's Christmas, which in and of itself is an emotional time as well as being grounded in religion. So my choice to sit and watch a film about prisoners largely in isolation, all trying to muddle on through this horrible mess by feigning the Christmas spirit, all the while examining themselves and each other and how their lives have moulded and shaped who they are, well, it was all too relevant in the moment for me. The script is astounding, easily one of the best I've ever seen. The pacing, while a little slow in the opening 15 minutes, quickly picks up, and from there it maintains momentum and grace right the way through to the end credits. There are no caricatures here. Every single character has been written to give depth, complexity, and detail. This isn't a film about goodies and baddies. This is a film about people and the events that made them. For Yonoi, a strict and religious upbringing has shaped him into a man who believes in equality and fairness to an almost ruthless degree. But his fairness conflicts with his spirituality, which dictates that a crime must be punished, even if there isn't a criminal or a reasonable solution. He also believes the sick are only truly sick because of spiritual laziness, which leads to many unwarranted fastings within the camp when orders aren't followed to the letter. This plays heavily in the second act onwards, but it's a character study in and of itself, as you see Yonoi slowly begin to break down as he struggles to ratify the idea of fairness and justice at all costs. Jack is another example of this, a man who spends his entire life fighting for people on behalf of people, being mishandled and feared by the gods as a devil for being as forward and uncompromising in fairness as he is. His story parallels Yonoi's throughout the film, with Yonoi influencing Jack and vice versa. And as the picture rolls on, we see Jack examine his own faults, chiefly among them being the one time he didn't step in at his brother's hazing initiation in boarding school, which resulted in his brother never being quite the same again. This clearly weighs heavily on him, as from the point that it's mentioned, the film constantly revisits this scenario in his mind. Characters aside, the dialogue here is also astoundingly good. It's incredibly naturalistic for the period and doesn't feel in any way padded. You get everything you need to know out of this film and not one line more. It's incredibly effective, and even small moments like Jack telling Lawrence about the incident with his brother that resulted in his brother never singing again, followed later by a flashback to Jack asking his brother for forgiveness, who shortly thereafter breaks into song, revealing that this incident never actually happened and that it was all still in Jack's head, is wonderfully low-key and really is a prime example of show-don't-tell cinema. Add in the aforementioned tonal themes and a finale that, well, if it doesn't move you, you're not bloody human, and you have a script that's razor-sharp, brimming with ideas, and is near-perfect in my opinion. The film was based on the novel The Seed and the Sower by Laurens Vanderpost. It was then adapted into a screenplay by Paul Meyersberg and the film's director, Nagisa Oshima. Nagisa is widely regarded as a master craftsman in the field of direction. He's probably best known in the West for this film and the rather infamous picture In the Realm of the Senses, a passionate but self-destructive look at affairs and toxic relationships. He had 41 directing credits, a lot of them are dealing with stronger erotic themes, which means that quite a few have never actually made their way over to Western shores. While I'm not extremely well versed in his oeuvre, I really struggle to see how he can top his work here. He also has 39 writing credits, including Gohato and Empire of Passion. While I'd argue his directorship is probably stronger than his writing ability, they're both most definitely of quality, especially in the context of some of the movies I've covered on here in the past. Unfortunately, Nagisa passed away in 2013 at the age of 80. Paul Meyersberg has 14 writing credits, and I was surprised but not shocked to discover that he wrote another David Bowie-led film, The Man Who Fell to Earth, which has a quasi-similar tone in terms of themes of isolation and discussing what characteristics make us human. And as an aside, that movie is also very good and definitely worth checking out too. He also wrote the adaptation of the Roger Corman, Vincent Price, Edgar Allan Poe classic, The Tomb of Ligeia, which I actually have sat on my shelf and watched on Blu-ray right now, and I'll be very quickly fixing that. Together, this novelist, director, and screenplay adapter have really turned out something wonderful here, that genuinely caught me by surprise. The direction here is visually stunning. It's rich, lush, and incredibly considered in its approach. This is a slow-burning film visually, and particularly in Blu-ray quality, you really get to soak in the absolutely gorgeous location work and compositional choices of each sequence. It has a level of distinction about it visually that I think is seldom seen in Western cinema productions, even though it does have some Western, in particular European, sensibilities about it. And with some astounding lighting choices that feel more theatrical in style than cinematographic, and some even more wonderful work on the editing front to help realise the director's vision, this is just a wonderfully shot movie that has a real sense of style and a keen eye for attention to detail. Equally, direction of the cast is top class too, with all performers consistently moving in or around the frame in meaningful ways, and just the right amount of heat and passion delivered at just the right moments, Oshima really has locked onto something special here. Though, with a core cast including Ryuichi Sakamoto, David Bowie, Tom Conti and Takeshi Kitano, it was always odds on going to be beyond passable in its quality. A short and sweet breakdown of the cine, it's great again. A minor niggle here is that they don't quite get one or two of the execution death scenes right. They go for the classy option of not being gratuitous, but showing just enough so that you get the idea. But at the same time, they're also working on a frenzy principle, whereby the sequence becomes more erratic as tension builds leading up to the death, with lots of quick cuts to reactions and the execution in action in order to create tension. It's quite the contrast to the rest of the movie that feels quite reasonably paced by contrast, and as such in these one or two moments it does kind of lose itself a bit. But mercifully they're few and far between. As for the rest of the film, the cine's top notch in my books, with some lovely ultra-wide tracking and panning shots of the surrounding Greenland contrasting with the dingier and collapsing prison camp bunks. They have a great mix of shot types throughout, with very little feeling unnecessary or gratuitous. So, a big thumbs up from me there. As mentioned, we have a stellar cast on display here, really giving it their all. Ryuichi Sakamoto may be a more familiar name to you if you like your electronic music, as he makes up 33.3% of the Yellow Magic Orchestra. And here, he plays the part of Captain Yonoi wonderfully. With a reserved demeanour and a fiery temper, the layers Sakamoto has to play with here in order to pull this role off would give most veteran seasoned actors a run for their money. But here, he makes it look effortless, so serious kudos to him on that front. The same can also be said for Takeshi Kitano as Sergeant Hara. I haven't really spoken about him much in this review, and that's because while he is an important character to the plot, he doesn't really have any major key playings in this. His character is quite easygoing, he just wants an easy life. Unfortunately, that easy life sometimes requires a few people to not be alive. And Hara and Lawrence have plenty of back and forths over the morality of killing, the ethics of running a POW camp, and they have in-depth discussions on life. Hara isn't fundamentally a bad person, he's just looking for results, whether the right person gets it or not. Which is a theme that plays out throughout the film with Hara in particular. Tom Conti is simply fantastic playing John Lawrence, in a performance that's both highly believable, frustrated and struggling to keep things together. He's the brooch that keeps the prisoners and the guards held together, and he's painfully aware of that. And Conti's performance here could not be more in tone with what the script requires. I honestly don't think I could see anyone else playing that role. He's probably the best performer in this film. And last, but by no means least, David Bowie's performance as Jack is a total delight. He has just the right level of snark and unwillingness to back down to really hammer home Jack's character. And while I'd never have thought Bowie could play a tough guy role, here his presence alone makes it clear he's not a man to mess with. I have only a single gripe about his performance here, and I have no idea whose idea it was to do this, but there's a bit in the second act where Jack flashes back to his childhood and his school days, For the opening part of the flashback, they choose to cast a child actor as Jack, and he's fine. He does a good job. But when we flash forward in time to Jack's later school days, Bowie is playing Jack as a schoolboy. Bowie was 34 years old at the time this film was made, and he was being asked to play, at oldest, a 19-year-old schoolboy. It was painfully surreal, and even though he doesn't perform particularly badly in those scenes, it was just a bit too much even for me. Mercifully, those scenes only last for about 5 to 10 minutes of the total runtime, but yeah, keep an eye out for that bit. And finally, the soundtrack. As the credits rolled on this film, I pulled my phone out and immediately bought this movie's soundtrack on vinyl and as MP3s. It's breathtaking. Ryuichi Sakamoto, alongside acting in this, scored the whole thing too, and my god, it's incredible. It's a synth-heavy score with a Japanese classical twist, and it feels ancient and fresh in equal measures. I think this may be my favourite non-vocal film score ever produced. It's totally listenable in and of itself. It's haunting and beautiful, and I loved, loved, loved it. If you can't tell by now, I quite liked this film. I went into it expecting something alright, but maybe a one-watch kind of film, and it proceeded to blow my socks off. It's a beautiful film that I feel genuinely and sincerely needs to be seen by more people, especially around Christmas. I mean, if Die Hard can be a Christmas film, then this sure as hell is. It left a bittersweet feeling of happiness and sadness that I still haven't shaken even weeks after watching it. Arrow Academy recently released this on Blu-ray, and I highly, highly recommend checking this one out.